right, congratulations to those of you that are able to drive over here this morning. About 10 of you. It is slippery, isn't it? Good thing Matt's a good driver. Marlena?
Matthew 4, 16 and 17. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And from that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near."
I saw the light. Welcome, everyone. I see you guys have all slid in here successfully this morning. Actually, the roads weren't really that bad. The worst were in Avoca. I don't know if from my trip. I don't know what it was for you guys. But we're glad that you're here, regardless of what the weather is like, that we can gather together to worship the Lord. It's worth it. He is worthy of our worship and our praise, and it is good for us to do this. We're going to spend a few minutes looking at his word together, so I invite you to turn to Psalm 20. I'm going to read this morning together, and then as you're turning there, to kind of help prepare us to understand the word, what is the battle that you're looking at this week, or maybe you're already in? Where's the struggle at? Where's the fight in your life? And then how are you going to address that? So, like Psalms, sometimes we overly generalize or poeticize, I don't know if that's the right word, but we think they're just flowery language often, or very metaphorical language, and they certainly are that. But they're also very specific. They're not just thinking of the psalmists, they're not just thinking of flowery terms and how to express beauty and stuff. They're actually very practical problems that they address. And so in Psalm 20, what do you do before a battle? This is a psalm that would have been composed before a battle, before a fight. And in verses 1 through 5, just so you kind of understand as you read it, it seems to be that it's the people that are interceding for the king. In verses 6 and 8 through 8, the king's response. And then one more time, the intercession in the last verse. So in that, with that kind of framework, let's consider Psalm 20 together this morning. For the director of music, a psalm of David. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifices and accept your burnt offerings. May he give you the desire of your heart, and may all your plans succeed. We will shout for joy when you are victorious, and will lift up our banners in the name of our God. May the Lord grant you all your requests. Then the king, now I know the Lord saves his anointed. He answers him from his holy heaven with the saving power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. They are brought to their knees and fall, but we rise up and stand firm. O Lord, save the king. Answer us when we call. That's good for any battle that anyone may be facing and dealing with. So with that, let's go to the Lord who saves this morning. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that we can gather together on this wintry, icy morning, that you have called us together, Lord, by your purpose and your design and your plan, your spirit at work in us, drawing us to gather together with the body of Christ to declare your praises, to seek your provision. Lord, there are literal battles that are raging across our world even today. And there are the spiritual battles behind them, the spiritual battles in our own lives, Lord, and around us, where it seems like the righteous will be swept away and the wicked will prosper and flourish. And we recognize, Lord, we come to you knowing that you save those who seek you, those who trust in you. We are surrounded, Lord, with people who are trusting all manner of things that they believe will bring them prosperity and success and victory in their lives. Lord, this morning, we again are affirming, we're returning to recognize that our trust is in you. And we call out to you this morning for your strength, for your salvation, Lord, apart from which we are lost forever. Lord, we ask that you would sustain us in your salvation. You would draw our hearts to your provision through your word and through your son, Jesus. That we would meditate on your word this morning as we worship you and as we sing to you. And that it would be in our hearts today and this week, Lord. And that we would be established in your salvation, Lord. We would walk in it. We would live in it. We would trust in you fully, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity to praise you, to listen to you, to give to you, to sacrifice to you this morning and today. We ask that you would lead us and guide us and uplift us. We ask this in the name of your Son and our Savior Jesus. Amen.
Lift up your name to call on our Savior, to fall on got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. Could I want more? The love of God gave me his pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God pulls me up higher. His will is stronger. It's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy.
you the praise for this morning, for the opportunity to come together, Lord, to worship you. Thank you for those that are able to come over the slippery roads this morning and be able to make it here. And ask that you would be with those that are staying home and watching online, Lord, that you would just help us all to be able to have an attitude of worship and learning from your word today. In Jesus' name.
And we will dismiss kids up through third grade whose parents would like them to go to junior church. And thank you, Tara, for filling in for those who couldn't get off the hill. It is good to be, okay? Pray for it, but there is some responsibility there as well. This one I like. Go ahead there, Isaac. Dear Lord, help me to be senile. Grant me the senility to forget the people I never liked anyway, the good fortune to run into the ones I do, and the eyesight to tell the difference. We're going to talk about prayer, probably not in that way. But as we do need to pray. We need to ask God to give us wisdom, to know how to apply his word to our lives. Let's do that. Father, we thank you. You're a great and awesome God. God who does hear our prayer. Father, we're grateful that you do not answer everything that we ask for. Because you know what's best. You know what's right. Father, thank you for changing us as we come before you and submit ourselves to you. Father, help us this year to be ever more mindful of prayer. We ask in Christ's name, amen. I do appreciate Brandon and Kevin filling in for me last week and bringing God's word. 2 weeks ago, we talked about why will Christ come, and I hope that you're still looking forward to him coming. He is coming to set up his kingdom on this earth, and that is indeed what we're trusting for him to do. But while we wait, we're supposed to be growing, and we're supposed to be becoming ever more like him. And prayer is one of those areas where it requires us to grow, myself included. I studying this week rather broad range of things that I was studying, and I think some of them we'll kind of cover as we go through this year, but I got to thinking, my prayer life needs improvement. I do thank you for praying. I hear quite often people express their gratitude that our people are praying. In the last 3 weeks, I've had 4 or 5 people from outside of our church ask for our church to pray. Why? Because they consider our church, our people, to be people who go before the Lord and intercede and ask him to do the amazing things that God does. And I'm very grateful for that. I'm thankful for 50-plus people who receive the prayer text or the prayer calls, for the 80-plus people who are on the email prayer chain, for the 80-plus people who take the weekly prayer sheet physically or by email and pray through the requests that we list there. Our missionaries regularly express their gratitude for the people who are praying. We send out 62 copies of the letters that they mail us by email so that you can be praying. I'm grateful for the small groups that pray weekly, for some groups that pray together almost daily, for the ladies' prayer partner ministry, that we pray when we begin meetings, that we get to pray as a congregation on Sunday mornings. However, I think there is cause for concern. Let me start by asking you this. You listen to these verses, and you tell me how it strikes you that God would have you obey these verses. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 2. You are to pray, and that you are to pray individually. And even in Scripture, I think a lot of the prayers that we see are individuals praying, okay? If you would turn back to Nehemiah 1, his prayer is one of the great prayers of Scripture, which I hope you'll see as it ties in at the very end. But Nehemiah finds out that his people are living in a city that does not have a wall, a city that's not protected. Okay, they've gone back, they've started rebuilding Jerusalem, and it comes to Nehemiah that there's persecution, there's problems, but the wall isn't being rebuilt. And so Nehemiah goes before God individually, privately, and this is the prayer that's recorded for us. Nehemiah 1:5. And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who love you and observe your commandments. Do you start your prayers like that? I hope you do. I hope you go before God, praising and recognizing him for the great God that he is. Because truthfully, if God's not great, why are you going before him? You know, petition the governor. Petition the president. Why do you go before God? Because God is great. Because he can actually do something. He does do stuff. You say, but it's not what I want. Then think about that. Please let your ear be attentive and your eyes open that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now, day and night. Perseverance, consistency. For the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned. Right? Again, another important component of prayer is that we go before God and we confess that we are sinners. Both my father's house and I have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you, have not kept the commandments, the statutes, nor the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Remember, I pray, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you're unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the farthest parts of the heavens, I will gather them there and bring them to the place which I've chosen as a dwelling for my name. Here, Nehemiah prays God's words back to him. God, this is your promise. Keep your promise. Punish us as you have. But God, you've also said that if we repent, you'll bring us back. These are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power, by your strong hand. Right? So that's one of the great prayers of Scripture. And it is one man beseeching God on behalf of a nation and on behalf of himself, God, do great things. Another great prayer that we think of. Turn to 1 Chronicles 29. 1 Chronicles 29, I'm starting in the end of verse 10. David said, blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory, the victory and the majesty. All that is in heaven and in earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord. You are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you. You reign over all. In your hand is power and might. In your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. David starts with, look, I'm going to get a good picture of who God is before I start asking him anything. Verse 13, now therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to offer so willingly as this? For all things come from you, and of your own we have given you. For we are aliens and pilgrims before you, as were all our fathers. Our days on earth are as a shadow without hope. O Lord our God, all this abundance that we have prepared to build you a house for your holy name is from your hand. They had been taking up the offering to build the tabernacle, to build the temple. And David is here at the end of his life and ministry that God has given him, and he is thanking God that the people have been so generous. And I would echo that in our own time. God has been good. We've met the budget yet again and exceeded it. And praise God, right? For moving in the hearts of people, for providing everything we have. O Lord our God, all this abundance that we have prepared to build you a house for your holy name is from your hand, is all your own. I know also, my God, that you test the heart and have pleasure in uprightness. And in David's prayer here, he's reminding himself that God looks at our hearts and he is concerned that our actions do reflect what God has commanded. Let me jump down to verse 18. O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, our fathers, keep this forever in the intent of the thoughts of the heart of your people and fix their heart toward you. O God, please don't let me forget how to obey you. O God, please let the motive of my heart be right. O God, please keep that forever set in my heart. And give my son Solomon a loyal heart to keep your commandments and your testimonies and your statutes, to do all these things and to build the temple for which I have made provision. All right, so David is there and he's praying. And if you got to 1 Chronicles 29 fast enough and you looked at verse 10, you realize that although this could have been a great prayer that David prayed by himself, he didn't. He's praying in front of all the people. But David isn't the only one who prays. Look how this finishes. Verse 20. Then David said to all the assembly, "Now bless the Lord your God." So all the assembly blessed the Lord God of their fathers, bowed their heads, prostrated themselves before the Lord and the king. They have a group prayer meeting, a corporate prayer meeting, right? They come before him and they pray together, all of them. We have in the New Testament a verse that we often quote, think of, "I tell you truly, if two or three of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven, for where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them." Right? So Scripture definitely talks about individual prayer and corporate prayer. Think about confessing sin. Right? 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that's talking about us going one-on-one to God. But we also have James 5:16, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that God will heal us. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We do that much less, right? But we're called to do that. And so what I would like us to consider from Scripture is this. I think we do fairly well, I hope, individually praying. And I think we do okay corporately. But I will tell you that one of my requests, one of my prayer requests for this year is that we would do better at praying together. More often, more of us. Why? Because there is a danger, right, in praying in front of people. Some of you are just like, "I had never opened my mouth in front of people." Can I encourage you to, you don't have to pray in front of the whole congregation, but find two or three people that you could pray with. It does need to be done carefully, okay? because unfortunately, some of you think of praying in front of people and you're like excited, right? How can I bless them with my spirituality? What kind of flowery phrases could I use to just impress people? And that would be a problem, right? Because then what are you doing? You're impressing people. And that is definitely not the way we should be going. Matthew chapter 6 reminds us, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. They love to pray standing in the synagogues on the street corners to be seen by others. When you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words. So there is a carefulness that needs to be done as we gather together to pray. Right, we're not here to impress one another. I will be very honest. Some of the greatest prayers I have ever heard are from people who have no idea how to pray. I love to hear people talk to God. And it's quite obvious they haven't got a clue that you have to start with Dear Father and end in Jesus' name. You really don't. Or we use those words because we just think it's like opening a letter and signing your name at the end, right? And that means we've lost the idea of what's actually involved in those words. I love hearing people pray who have no clue that you don't just talk to God. It's weird, right? Because we're really used to church prayers. And, you know, not that there's always anything wrong with that. But are we really considering who we're talking to and how we're talking to God? And that we're not really coming together to impress one another. What we are coming together to do is to unite together in prayer. John 17, Jesus prays. Jesus prays. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them, you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. All right? And it is definitely something that I've seen happen, right? That we begin to pray together and God unites our hearts, right? Part of the reason for this, okay, is let me go back to an old example, okay? We were going to put a wood stove in our house, and I'm thinking through, okay, the best place to put the wood stove is in the living room, okay? It's a big room. It's got two pocket doors that can open up. It can heat both sides of the house, and I've got it all figured out. This is the best plan. And Kathy goes, no way. And I'm like, yes way. No way. Look, I have this figured out. I know what's best. She goes, no. It needs to go in the back room because we're going to be carrying wood in. You don't want to do that across the carpet. Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, you're right, the back room is the best room. Isn't that the plan I came up with? No, it was hers. And it was a good plan. But it's like that, right? As we go together in prayer, and as we pray, and I hear you pray about something and think, oh, yeah. Yeah, that might be a better way for God to work because that's what his word says. Oh. Right? As we pray together, as we seek God together, he unites our hearts. Well, we've asked that you begin praying as to how we could use the land, right? That God is graciously putting in front of us. Because we're not entirely sure. We're coming to seek God. How is the best way to use this? And, you know, everybody's got their own idea, and I'm sure God has his idea. It'd be good to figure out that we get on God's page, right, as soon as possible. Corporate prayer allows us to encourage and support other believers. 1 Thessalonians 5:11. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. And by praying together, we have the opportunity to encourage one another. I understand when people say, hey, can you pray for this? I have often said, yep, I'll pray for it. And I will admit, I know it never happens to you. I will admit that sometimes when I say I will pray for that, I forget about it within the next 30 seconds. I've got a lot going, right? And so I have found it to be profitable to pray right then. I have found it profitable that when I'm going through Facebook and somebody comes up with a request, that I take the time and actually write the prayer out. Why? Because, one, it's encouraging to them, right? But it reminds me, it focuses me, it helps me to do that which I should be doing. I should be praying together with. Praying together encourages one another. We're told to spur one another on to love and to good works. So, a couple of things. One, we don't really get a picture from Scripture that corporate prayer is more powerful than private prayer. If we all gang up on God, he's going to have to give us what we want. Right? That's not what Scripture is telling us. But it does tell us to come together and pray. The power in corporate prayer is in its ability to unify us around God's will, not get things from God. All right, so then let me express something else. And I've wrestled with this most of the week as I thought through, this is where God's pushing me. I don't want to make you feel guilty for not being involved in a prayer meeting. One, because if I can make you feel guilty, someone else can make you unguilty. That's not my intention, not my heart, and I don't think it's profitable. But can I ask you to please go before God and say, Lord God, are there other people that I should be praying with? Lord God, can I show up on a prayer meeting night? Or could I show up on Tuesday afternoon or Wednesday afternoon? Or we've got more small groups that we're hoping to start here in February, and part of the ministry of small groups is praying together. Lord, will I, can I, should I take the time, make the sacrifice, find a group that I can get together with that can spur me on and I can encourage as well? Again, my heart is not to make you feel guilty, but it is part of my responsibility to remind us when we're failing to do what God tells us to do. And I think that part of the reason that we lack the power that we should have is that we as a congregation don't come together. not in the last 2 years because of, you know, the great regulations that were going on, but in the 2 years prior to that, we scheduled 4 or 5 special prayer meetings. I don't think we ever had above 3 people show up. If we as a church are not willing to come together to seek God, what are we doing? Again, please do not misunderstand. Feeling guilty won't solve any of this. But seeking God and saying, look, God, I know prayer needs to be more a part of my life, and I know prayer needs to be more a part of our church's life. And feeling that call, I'm going to figure out how you would have me do that. Right? We're not taking attendance. That's not the point. The point is, will we do what God calls us to do? As I was thinking through this, come back with me to one of my favorite examples of corporate prayer, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Jehoshaphat is king. They come to him and they say, there is a huge army that is going to wipe us out. And Jehoshaphat says, okay, let's pray. I have no idea how we are going to beat this army. We are in a situation that we cannot fix. In 2 Chronicles 20, verse 3, Jehoshaphat feared. Right? It was a scary thing. And he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. So Judah gathered together to ask help from the Lord. And from all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. And they came together to corporately pray. They came together in a prayer meeting. And Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the court and said, O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? Do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand, is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, forever? They dwell in it, have built you a sanctuary in it. If disaster comes upon us, sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this temple and in your presence, for your name is in the temple, and cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save. O our God, verse 12, will you not judge them? For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. Now all Judah, with their little ones, their wives and their children, stood before the Lord. Everybody showed up. Why? Because there was a crisis. I can name several crises that we have. Maybe you can too. Should we probably not be praying together? So as I was studying, let me finish up with this, and part of the reason why I read the passages of Scripture that I did. What to pray. Okay, our prayer sheet has got a lot of physical needs on it. And I believe that we should pray for physical needs. Okay? I pray that you may enjoy good health. That's 3 John 2. But I was challenged again as I was studying that if that's all we're praying for each other, we're messing it up pretty badly, right? We should be praying. As Kevin's taken you through Ephesians chapter 1, the great prayer in Ephesians 1, I'm going to read the parallel in Colossians 1. Have you been praying that for each other? Because we should be. God, give complete knowledge of your will. Give spiritual wisdom and understanding, that the way my friend may live will always honor and please you, that their lives will produce every kind of good fruit, that they will grow as they learn to know God better and better. Lord God, I pray that they would be strengthened with all your glorious power, so that they will have all the endurance and patience that they need. May they be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. Or do you pray Ephesians 3 for people? Because you should. Scripture is full of prayers that we should be echoing back to God. Lord God, I pray that my congregation, that I would know the riches of your glory, that you would grant us to be strengthened with power through your Spirit in our inner being, that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what's the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. Those are great things to be praying. And so, let's pray. Lord God, we know we fall short in so many areas. And we ask, Lord, we pray, we seek you, that, Lord, that you would raise us up to be better prayer warriors. That we would be children totally dependent upon our Father to meet the needs of ourselves. That we would spend time praying individually, and that, Father, that you would increase our time spent praying together. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Let me just draw a few things to your attention. If you haven't given us your current information, please make sure that you do that. Don't forget that the worship times have changed, and so I'm actually technically still not late preaching. Sunday school started at 10:15. It goes a little bit longer. Sunday night, come back. We'll be in Isaiah. We sang "Holy, Holy, Holy" this morning, and that is Isaiah 6, and that's where we're at this evening. As MAPS kids also meet in youth group. I mentioned we will be starting some more small groups as we come into February, but there are three groups that are meeting currently, and you are more than welcome to join us. If you have questions, please ask. Awana meets on Wednesday night. I've got two slides for Awana because it's important. Homesteaders is starting back up this week with the co-op, Sewing for Others, Encouragers, and the men will be meeting as well. One of the new ministries that we're starting this year, we were going to start it, and then the pandemic hit, and that didn't happen. So we're going to go to Isaac, if you can move back one. Community supper. And here is our heart, okay? We would like to see the community get to know us, get to know the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And one of the ways that we can do that, I told you 2 weeks ago that if the Israelites had just listened, they would have been the party animals of the planet. It's true, right? Because God centers a lot of things around food, all right? So invite people to come. And then if you're here, make an effort to talk to other people, all right? To make them feel welcome, to make them enjoy their time. And don't be afraid to tell them, hey, come to church. Right, we don't actually get to eat in the sanctuary, but we have a Greater time eating God's word, right? And so please invite people. And I intentionally have put this on both the next two slides. When we post something on Facebook, if you will like it, if you will comment on it, if you will share it, it will reach our community much better, right? If all you do is scroll by it, most people will never get to see it, and most people will do the same. If you'd like to help, you can do that simply by doing that. All right, now next slide, Isaac. The other one is the Sportsman's Game Dinner is coming up, another opportunity to eat, but also another opportunity when we'll be sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's it. We're done. I'm late. Go.